One of the region's growing problems is heroin.
Now, most of the attention, of course, focused on the user, but there's a smaller victim in some cases.
WLWT News 5 investigative reporter Todd Dykes has the impact on the babies born to mothers addicted to the drug.
All she does is smile, giggle.
At first glance, this mom and baby look like any other mother and child. But take a closer look and you'll see a baby who was withdrawing from drugs right after she entered the world.
When she was born, I was a nervous wreck.
For the first few months of Crystal's pregnancy, she was an addict.
People are dying left and right off it. And mine was heroin, of course. It ruined my life.
But baby April is proof that life can and does go on. She's also proof the region's heroin epidemic can affect anybody, even newborns.
And the worst case is they have seizures as they're withdrawing.
Dr. Jim Greenberg, a neonatology expert at Children's Hospital, says there's been a spike in the number of babies impacted by illegal drugs, first because of pain pills like OxyContin, and now because of heroin.
And it's not as if heroin is better or special, it's just easier to acquire and ironically less expensive.
In some cases, babies are born with NAS, or neonatal abstinent syndrome.
The babies who are affected are affected in a variety of ways. They are irritable, relentless irritability that doesn't stop, and these babies sleep infrequently, and they are sometimes hyper alert.
And the numbers are staggering. In 2009 in Greater Cincinnati, 58 newborns were exposed to some kind of opiate during pregnancy. By last year, the total skyrocketed to 659. And in 2013, nearly 200 of those babies, including 78 exposed to heroin, had to be treated for neonatal abstinence syndrome.
While one child exposed to heroin during pregnancy is one child too many, doctors and nurses do the best they can, but doing the best they can is not always easy.
Because it turns out to be fairly complex.
In part, that's because the heroin epidemic is impacting more and more women.
It's ridiculously easy to find. It's everywhere.
Bethany was using when she got sick several months ago. She ended up in the hospital and found out she was 6 weeks pregnant.
I hated my addiction. As soon as I found out I was pregnant, it was, you know, I don't have a choice anymore. This is it. I have to do something about this.
Bethany and Crystal both ended up at First Step Home, an agency in Walnut Hills helping women and families break the cycle of addiction.
It's been unbelievable. Probably 3 years ago, very few women we had in our program were addicted to opiates, and now probably 85% of our women are addicted to opiates and heroin.
And the women are coming from all over.
Probably 80% of our clients are Caucasian, and they're coming from the suburb.
For moms and babies hooked on heroin, programs like First Step Home can be lifesavers.
So you can get as much help as you need if you want to. You have to want to.
Yeah, it was like my saving grace.
Todd Dykes, WLWT News 5.
So the long-term outlook for babies born to addicted mothers remains a mystery, but doctors say the initial outcomes have been good. They just don't have the long-term data yet.
Local hospitals are taking a unique approach tonight to detect drug-addicted babies who might otherwise go untreated. As heroin devastates families in Greater Cincinnati, doctors and nurses here are on a trailblazing path to protect newborns.
Investigative reporter Todd Dykes joins us live now with the controversial program to test pregnant women for drugs. Todd.
Yeah, it certainly is, and it's happening here in Cincinnati and hospitals around here. It's called universal testing, and it's now commonplace at almost 24 area hospitals. Experts think we may be one of only a few cities in the U.S. testing every mother before childbirth. The results are already helping our most vulnerable population.
So this is Anna Denson. She's 18 months old.
Baby Anna, born healthy and happy.
There's nothing more amazing.
Anna's mom remembers giving birth like it was yesterday, including the questions she was asked by nurses.
Do you smoke? Do you have, how frequently do you drink alcohol?
Anna's mom, Dora Annam, knows how important those questions are because of the work she does with the Health Collaborative.
When we worked on this project, we kept going back to this issue of what about the baby?
The project Anum is talking about pushed hospitals in Greater Cincinnati to do more than just ask pregnant women about drug use. Since late 2013, 18 area hospitals have drug tested women by collecting urine samples. The purpose? To see if their babies are exposed to opiates or heroin during pregnancy.
We need to know if the baby's been exposed to opioids so they don't have withdrawal when they leave.
Dr. Scott Wexelblad is an expert on the needs of newborns. He says nearly 8% of babies born in Greater Cincinnati are exposed to drugs in the womb. If the exposure involves pain pills or heroin, babies can develop neonatal abstinence syndrome. That means they're born craving the drug their mom used. While pregnant women can decline to be tested, only a fraction have.
Other states are making it criminal if you are testing positive. So our whole approach is this was a non-punitive approach.
Universal pregnancy drug testing has critics who call it too intrusive. Dora Anum admits when local health experts first discussed the idea, there were concerns not only about privacy but about legal liabilities. But faced with a growing heroin epidemic, hospitals took a unified stand, knowing testing can lead to healthier newborns. It's a model Wexelblad believes will one day become the norm across the country.
I think it should be happening elsewhere, and I think it will be happening elsewhere in the future. This, in my opinion, should be normal prenatal care, and I think in the future it will be.
Well, supporters say the impact is easy to see. During a study at Mercy Anderson, a number of pregnant women did test positive for opioids. 19 of the women who tested positive did not present any risk factors during that standard Q&A screening process. It's likely those 19 babies would not have received any specialized care based on the way things used to be done. Todd Dykes, WLWT News 5.
Todd, thank you. Now, if a mom refuses to give a urine sample, her baby is still tested. And while Ohio law does not impose criminal penalties when tests are positive, Child Protective Services is notified. 18 Greater Cincinnati hospitals are participating in this program. Go to our website, WLWT.com, to see that list.
A local family dealing with heroin in a way they never could have imagined.
Yeah, and what happened to them is something that a lot of people maybe wouldn't want to talk about publicly, but their explanation actually began with a notice that they put in the local paper. WLWT News 5's Brian Hamrick talked with the family today. He joins us live now from the Hamilton County Justice Center. Brian?
Yeah, Cherie. Well, the Hesse family is a large, tight-knit family, but one of them was scheduled to be in court today on heroin charges. He was a no-show. But his mother was here, and a couple of weeks ago, she told the court he wouldn't be here. And what seems eerie now, she told them why.
Alex Hesse was born with a big family and dreams.
He was so smart.
Even bigger.
Nobody could beat him on the golf course. Nobody could beat him on the baseball field. Nobody could beat him on the football field. He was the best.
But Alex was changed by a force his parents describe as pure evil.
It was a demon. It was heroin, and it took over his life.
It doesn't take more than one time with heroin. One time you take it, and you're hooked.
Heroin is the reason Alex wasn't in court today. It killed him last Monday.
Nobody wanted it more than him to get better, and it took over. It took over him and made him a different person.
Now, Alex's family is preparing for his funeral, watching his life flash before their eyes in dozens of pictures. But they're not keeping quiet about how he died, taking the unusual step of mentioning it as part of the obituary published in the paper.
His brother Andrew and his sister Allie wrote his obituary and felt necessary to let other people know that this drug kills.
The obituary says in part, hopefully by making more people aware of Alex's struggle, we can shed some light on this devastating issue.
It is an epidemic. It's worse than the plague, and it is wiping out an entire generation.
I don't know how we're going to stop this, but it is an epidemic, and we need somehow, some way to stop this.
It's left an entire family fighting the demons of their son, even after his death.
Now, Alex's mother was back here in court today to tell the judge what happened. It's the same place where she was when she told the judge to keep her son in jail. He'd been picked up on some drug charges. She told him in what seems eerie now that he'd never make this court date alive if he was released from jail. He was released because of jail overcrowding. Reporting live, Brian Hamrick, WLWT News 5.
And their story hits home for so many local families. Brian, thank you. Help Over Heroin, a three-day event, is expected now to draw thousands of people into Hamilton, all to help fight a deadly trend that is growing in many, many tri-state neighborhoods. Karen Johnson is leading the way for us tonight with the hope Hamilton has tonight. Karen?
Well, first event of its kind for the tri-state. Dozens of churches are coming together to make this happen. You can see the no parking signs are already up, and organizers are hoping to fill this entire parking lot with people and families looking for help.
I didn't grow up in a poor family. I didn't grow up in, you know, an abusive home or a traumatic upbringing.
Lori Johnson grew up a pastor's daughter, a childhood filled with laughter and love, but there were insecurities. And at 17,
I can remember just thinking I had found what I was looking for.
Drug of choice, pain pills. Within a year, Lori was hooked. Heroin use followed.
I lied, I stole, I robbed my family.
The next 15 years were spent in and out of jail cells and treatment programs. Lori even used during three pregnancies.
I finally got to that place of just desperation. My parents weren't speaking to me. I hadn't seen my children for months, and I was dope sick.
Lori was sentenced to the Darlene Bishop Home for Life at Solid Rock Church.
This was my room when I was here.
Here, Lori says she reconnected with herself and her faith.
There is life after heroin. There really is.
Hope after heroin, the message she and many others will share this weekend. 30 local churches are uniting for a three-day event in Hamilton.
There's no like they're going to jail or they're going to hospital, they're going into body bags. But I think the need is the presence of God back in the public square.
There will be counselors, recovery program representatives, music, food, and a prayer walk.
This is like all the different churches, all pointing the same direction, trying to do the same thing. But if you connect them all, you have a net. You can catch more fish with a net.
Hopefully put more people on the path to recovery.
We weren't destined to be heroin addicts. You're not destined to be hopeless for the rest of your life. You know, there's a greater purpose.
And the Hope Over Heroin event kicks off tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. It's right across the street from the Butler County Government Services Building, downtown Hamilton. It will continue again Saturday night at 7 o'clock. Then on Sunday at 6 o'clock, there'll be a prayer walk. Reporting live tonight in Hamilton, Karen Johnson, WLWT News 5.
All right, Karen, inspiring for sure. Several thousand people again are expected to attend this prayer walk. Organizers suggest that you get there early.
Police officers in Cincinnati could soon have a new weapon to fight drug overdose deaths, but the plan isn't sitting well with everyone. WLWT News 5's Allison Montoya explains how it could save lives, but many worry about the consequences. Allison.
Well, Mike, good evening to you. And Chief Jeffrey Blackwell tells me earlier today that he hopes to have this drug, Narcan, in the hands of his officers here in Cincinnati by the end of summer. And although controversial, he says his officers are here to save lives. It's a problem that's not going away anytime soon.
I think the entire United States has some type of heroin problem. Certainly here in the tri-state region, we have an epidemic.
With at least one overdose each day in the city or surrounding area, Cincinnati Police Chief Jeffrey Blackwell wants to arm his officers on the streets with Narcan.
I think we owe it to the citizens of our community to do everything we can to keep people safe and alive.
Narcan, also known by the off-brand name Naloxone, reverses the effects of opioids on the brain, bringing a person back to life after a fatal overdose. Charlotte Wethington lost her son Casey to addiction nearly 12 years ago and is all for Chief Blackwell's plan.
So I'm only left, Allison, to wish that we had had all of those tools. But I am so grateful that we have those tools now, and it behooves us to use the tools that are available to us.
Wethington and her husband are also hopeful that Kentucky's law agencies will follow in the chief's footsteps, but until then, they are using their son's VW van to distribute naloxone kits to families who need them.
We know that people can and do recover, but we have to keep them alive long enough to do that.
As for the CPD, it's not clear how much the kits will cost the department, and Blackwell said the department's attorneys have done their homework considering liability and that the time is now to help those in need most.
Once we move on this, Allison, we're going to move, and I think it's an important thing to move on.
Now, I recently today reached out to the Cincinnati Police Union president for comment, and I did not receive a call back yet. Reporting live from District 1 headquarters, Allison Montoya, WLWT News 5.
All right, Allison, Chief Blackwell says Cincinnati will be the first major metropolitan police department in the state of Ohio to give Narcan to officers. And just yesterday, Attorney General Eric Holder urged federal law agencies to identify workers who can administer the drug Narcan so they too can start carrying it out on the streets.
Well, the video may seem humorous, but the message is as serious as the sound of a jail cell door slamming. WLWT News 5's Karen Johnson shows you the Butler County Sheriff's new warning and how it's being received on the streets of Hamilton.
Sheriff Richard Jones' latest attempt to target heroin dealers is an online video. The sheriff says he's had 50,000 views in 10 hours, but not everyone is happy about it.
Attention, tri-state heroin dealers. Yes, you. Come enjoy our all-inclusive Butler County experience.
To some, it's catchy.
Parties, air shows, curbside service, complimentary bracelets, quality lodging, and a helpful concierge staff.
Sheriff Jones is always trying to do something. They may laugh at it, but it makes a lot of sense.
The PSA-style tourism video welcomes drug dealers to Butler County. It's intended to promote the county's new anonymous tip line.
He fights for the Butler County, which is good.
While the tongue-in-cheek video has some laughing, others are disappointed by it.
I think he needs to take it a little bit more serious. You know, there's people out here dying from this stuff.
I seen a kid that was 10 years old the other day shooting up in the alley. A 10-year-old.
That, Randy and Renee say, is no laughing matter. The two have also had their own lives affected by the heroin epidemic.
Because of heroin, I went to foster care in 2012.
Renee wasn't addicted, but she says her sister, her guardian, was.
I miss her so much. It's like I've never had that sister bond. My brothers started heroin. My uncle started heroin. My cousins. I've lost all my family to heroin.
For that reason, Renee says the tone of the video bothers her. It is, however, starting to explode on the internet. And with every share, an important message is being spread.
Some restrictions apply. Complimentary bracelets not available in all areas. See Sheriff Richard K. Jones for details.
And you could submit an anonymous tip to the sheriff's office here in Butler County through a text message or through the website. And we put a link on our website, WLWT.com. In Hamilton, Karen Johnson, WLWT News 5.
Karen, thanks. The Ohio Attorney General's office says the number of heroin overdoses is growing by the day. Earlier this year, a new heroin investigative unit was created in the state. If you'd like to check out Sheriff Jones' video, the entire video is on our website. That's WLWT.com.
Arming families of addicts with tools to reverse an overdose. A new state program is now giving three hospital systems over in Kentucky enough money to provide free Narcan kits to patients who come to the emergency room for an overdose. As Jackie Conjato explains tonight, St. Elizabeth in Northern Kentucky was picked because of the area's high rate of heroin overdose deaths. Jackie.
Yes, Cherie, St. E officials tell me that it's going to take them about 30 days to get these kits up and running, but at that point, they hope to send every overdose patient's family home with two vials of Narcan and enough instruction to save a life.
Horrible night. Unbelievable. Probably one of the worst things we ever went through.
David Steritz is talking about the first time his 21-year-old son overdosed 5 years ago. Since then, it's happened two more times, and each time, the drug Narcan, which reverses the overdose, was close enough to save him.
This gives us a chance for them to recover. This gives us a chance for them to ask for help.
In May, he and his wife got their own Narcan kit with a prescription.
If my son relapses, it's here. We can save him.
Now, with newly approved state funding, people who come to any St. Elizabeth emergency room suffering from a heroin overdose will leave with a Narcan rescue kit free of charge.
But it's going to have two 2-milligram vials of Narcan and then this atomizer here.
Until now, families leaving the ER would need a prescription and would sometimes have to pay to get it filled.
Whereas if we give it to them, we know that we're giving them, putting something in the community that's going to save a life, rather than giving them a prescription where they have to go hunt for something to be able to save a life.
Opponents are critical that making the anecdote more widely available will only encourage users.
If it was their son or their daughter, they want that kit right next to them. That 10 seconds, that 2 minutes may be the difference of reviving them or not.
Steritz says it's thanks to this drug that there's still hope for recovery.
He's on the upswing as far as we can see.
Now, this program is funded using settlement money from a pharmaceutical lawsuit. The judge in that case ordered that all settlement funds go towards treatment. Reporting live tonight, Jackie Conjato, WLWT News 5.
Jackie, thank you. And the number of heroin overdoses is on the rise. We looked into the numbers, and St. Elizabeth reporting that 745 overdoses happened last year at all five of its local emergency rooms. You compare that to 2011 when they saw 252. Last month alone, they had 123 cases of heroin overdoses.
A second deadly overdose inside the Hamilton County Jail is prompting new action tonight.
Right, and commanders say they do not know how convicted killer Daniel Davis got a hold of heroin while locked up, but they are tightening security now. WLWT News 5's John London is live for us tonight at the Justice Center with the battle behind bars. John.
Yeah, they're going to do some enhanced training, Cherie. They already have a sophisticated scanning system. They do random canine drug searches. They point out that a lethal dose of heroin is about the size of this Sweet and Low packet. What they do know is that addicts are desperate, and they see thousands of them processed through intake every year. One prisoner even swallowed a balloon of heroin prior to sentencing, had to be rushed to the hospital. Balloons show up as shadows on the scanner, so the coroner is going to provide more training for detection. But this jail is literally the largest detox center in the region.
Over 9,000 people came through this system in 2013 that was using heroin. So that in itself tells you there's a big demand for that drug, whether you're outside or inside. And unfortunately, on this occasion at least, something this size slipped through the system.
And they do not know how the heroin got in. We asked them, and they answered that they do not suspect that there is anything involving staff employees or jail guards, that they do an extensive criminal background check and are very diligent about making sure staff is not involved in any criminal activity. They see what happened as a symptom of a larger societal problem. Live at the Justice Center, John London, WLWT News 5.
So in the months to come, a mini intake center will be set up at the courthouse to try and catch any drugs before prisoners arrive at our jail.
It's horrible. I mean, it's horrible. They could have asked him for the money and he would have just given them the money.
A neighborhood in shock after the murder of a Lachlan businessman kidnapped and killed, leaving the bank.
It could have been anybody. It could be me.
Tonight, new details about a second person under arrest.
Investigators say it was a crime of opportunity driven by drugs. Good evening, I'm Cherie Pallello.
And thanks for joining us. I'm Mike Dardis. Many in the Lachlan area feared that they could have just as easily been the victim. Now a twist. More than one person involved in the murder, according to the prosecutor. Tonight, WLWT News 5's Brian Hamrick taking a closer look at the suspects. He is live right now at the Justice Center. Brian?
Yeah, Mike, today we're learning more about these suspects in this violent murder. One of them has been here at the Justice Center ever since the body of that victim was found. The other suspect just revealed, and we're finding even those who knew him well are stunned.
The violent murder of a well-known Lachlan businessman takes a new turn as indictments reveal a second suspect. Prosecutors call Jason Brown a killer. Those who knew him can't grasp it.
Well, Jason was a good guy.
Lemanuel Scales lives just across the street from Brown and has known him for nearly a decade.
He'd come over here or whatever and we'd talk about our problems to each other. So it's kind of a shock to, you know, me, his parents, and the neighbors and everybody, you know.
Also indicted in the murder, Christopher McFerrin. He was already under arrest. Police say McFerrin was seen on a bank security camera getting into James Roman's car. Roman was later found dead with a gunshot wound to the back of the head. McFerrin led police on a chase the same day Roman's body was found. He was arrested after holding a gun to his own head and swallowing heroin.
Mr. Roman was a wonderful guy. He really was. He was well-liked, loved by everyone.
At the Bridge Restaurant, just around the corner from where the victim worked and both suspects lived.
It's definitely a talk. Everyone has been talking about it.
People just can't fathom it all. Many, like Cherie Bobo, who works at the restaurant and knew all of the people involved, says there's an eerie feeling in the tight-knit neighborhood. It's the same one where Wanda Glenn was stabbed to death just a street away. Unrelated crimes, some say the suspects all share a common problem.
And what do you think the common thread is here?
The heroin. It's the drugs.
Now, Brown was arrested in Butler County. He's waiting to be extradited. That's not been determined when that will happen yet. Meanwhile, McFerrin remains here at the Justice Center. He's waived his arraignment, but he's being held on a $1.3 million bond. Reporting live, Brian Hemrick, WLWT News 5.
All right, Brian, thank you. Both Brown and McFerrin are charged with aggravated murder, aggravated robbery, and kidnapping.
It'll create too many additional issues, and we have enough issues in the community already.
Yeah, neighbors very troubled tonight over the possibility of having a drug treatment center right in their backyards. WLWT confirmed today plans are in the works to open a facility for addicts in the city of Mason.
They're calling it an opiate therapy replacement center. WLWT News 5's Karen Johnson leading the way with the drug clinic controversy in Mason.
Officials here in Mason are being very tight-lipped about the details, but I was able to confirm that heroin addicts may soon have a new place to go for help right here in Mason. The Lindner Center of Hope sits on 36 acres of land off Old Western Road Boulevard in Mason. We've confirmed the mental health center is now looking to expand its addiction services and open an opiate replacement therapy center. Like methadone clinics, it would treat those addicted to heroin and other opiates.
And I have a son in Tennessee that goes to the methadone clinic. It saved his life.
Anytime you can help him, because, I mean, Cincinnati is having a problem with heroin addicts.
Sources tell us the Lindner Center is eyeing land around 42 and 741. A spokeswoman for the Center of Hope says it's too premature to discuss those details, but did confirm they're looking to stay close to the Old Western Row location. That has some people concerned.
I don't think anybody wants it in their community. I don't know. Somewhere out where it's not around families.
I know exactly what kind of people would bring to the neighborhood, and I'd have to move again, and I would.
City officials declined to comment on specifics, but Councilman Rich Cox said the Lindner Center of Hope understands the heroin epidemic in this area. Mason could not ask for a better partner with their reputation and understanding on how to treat people with this horrible addiction. Vice Mayor Victor Kidd said everything the Lindner Center does, they do with excellence. But not everyone who lives around here is convinced Mason is the place for it.
They need to put it in the communities that need it. I don't think this awesome place needs it.
And I did check with the city of Mason, and I was told it has not received any applications or building permits related to this project. In Mason, Karen Johnson, WLWT News 5.
Cincinnati police are now carrying a life-saving drug for heroin overdose victims. Good evening, I'm Cherie Palello.
And thanks for joining us. I'm Mike Dardis. Narcan will allow officers to treat heroin addicts before paramedics get there. WLWT News 5's Emily Wood, live now with more on the program and how the department is funding it. Emily.
Good evening, Mike. The drug Narcan has been around for decades, but this is the first time Cincinnati police officers will carry it. And to start, two units, the Central Business District Unit and the Quality of Life Unit, will carry Narcan for a six-month period. Now armed with Narcan, Cincinnati police officers have the power to treat a heroin overdose. Given through the nose, the drug opens up the airway and can save a person's life. Angela Wells lost her son Nathan to a heroin overdose in January of 2013. She says Narcan would have saved his life and been a major wake-up call to recovery.
We desperately need Narcan. It is a necessary tool that we need to save lives during this epidemic.
Hundreds of police departments across the country already use Narcan, but Cincinnati is the largest department in Ohio to carry it. Lieutenant Lisa Davis says it's starting with 100 units of Narcan at $25 a piece for a total cost of $2,500. And each unit provides 2 to 4 doses of Narcan.
Angela is my sister, and so this is very close to my heart just because losing a nephew, I mean, it's something that, again, it crosses every socioeconomic. Everybody could probably know someone that's been affected by this.
But nationwide, critics say Narcan only enables heroin addicts to keep abusing. So we asked the chief if the cost is worth it.
I'm not buying into that criticism. We have a responsibility to help save lives when and where we can. So if we give a person a second chance, they can get the help they need to stay alive.
The chief and Lieutenant Davis also called on the community to use its quality of life officers and report any and all suspicious drug activity in this park and around the neighborhood. The department department made the announcement this afternoon, just about 2.5 hours ago, right here in Stanberry Park in the middle of Mount Washington, because trails back here are known spots for heroin addicts. Reporting live tonight in Mount Washington, Emily Wood, WLWT News 5.
All right, Emily, thank you. The police department is funding this Narcan program through drug asset forfeiture funds, so it's not costing the taxpayers any more money.